This video discusses an article with the following title, Achieving Cooperation Under Anarchy, Strategies and Institutions. It was written by Robert Axelrod and Robert O. Keohane. It was published in World Politics in 1985. Robert Axelrod is a professor of political science and public policy at the University of Michigan. He is best known for his interdisciplinary work on the evolution of cooperation. His current research interests include complexity theory, and especially agent-based modeling, international security, and cybersecurity. Robert Keohane is an American who is associated with the theory of neoliberal institutionalism, as well as transnational relations and world politics in international relations in the 1970s. He is currently a professor of political science at Princeton University. He is said to be one of the most influential recent international relations scholars. I will start by explaining four models of game theory, which are used in the article. Game theory concerns strategic models which map the position of rational decision makers. The four models that I show in my picture are dilemmas, where the player chooses between cooperation and defection. The four models that I show in my picture sometimes present dilemmas and sometimes present a set of choices, where the player chooses between cooperation or defection. They are shown in the image. These are the prisoner's dilemma, chicken, the stag hunt, and deadlock. The four sets of squares that you see each show a game. The game is a scenario where the player must choose between two options. These are cooperation with the other player or defection of the other player. The game is a scenario where the player must choose between two options. These options are either cooperating with the other player or defecting from the other player, in effect betraying them. The row shows the first player's choice, and the column shows the second player's choice. In the prisoner's dilemma game, imagine you are arrested and asked by the police to betray your fellow criminal. Your fellow criminal is asked the same. If you both betray each other, you both get 5 years jail time. If you both stay silent, you both get 1 year jail time. If one player betrays the other while that other stays silent, only one player gets 10 years of jail time. Rationally, then, both players would stay silent, but for lack of knowing the intentions of the other, both end up betraying each other. In the game of chicken, next, imagine two cars driving into each other, which are about to collide. The car that swerves is the cowardly chicken. But the loss of dying is so great compared to the trivial loss of swerving that both cars end up swerving. In the stag hunt, imagine going on a hunt for either a hare or a stag. You can catch a hare if you hunt on your own, but you can catch a stag only if you set out to hunt a stag, and you get the help of another hunter who chooses the same. While not knowing the intentions of the other, both players will end up choosing to hunt the stag rather than the hare, because they are confident that the other player trusts all players to hunt the stag. Last, deadlock is a game where defection is always preferable to cooperation. Above the titles of the games, I show an order of preference for the player. It shows what the preferred outcomes are for player 1. D is defection and C is cooperation. The first letter is the action of player 1 and the second letter is the action of player 2. We must note three things here. First, the player always reasons from what the other player's intentions are and chooses their own strategy accordingly. Second, those interests are based on the reward or punishment from losing or winning. Third, how high or low the score is depends on what the players perceive the reward to be, rather than what the reward actually is. This means that the type of game can change according to how the players perceive themselves and others. Now I will proceed to the article. This article is framed by the difficulty of enforcing cooperation in world politics. This difficulty arises due to the lack of a world government to police states. This is known as anarchy in international relations. The coercive power of international institutions is weak. However, cooperation still happens, and war is not perpetual. We must explain why. Anarchy does not deny international society. This society does not lack organization. Anarchy is constant, but the way in which state interactions are structured is not constant. Lipson says that military relationships are much less institutionalized than economic relationships are. To explain these things, we follow the game theorist. Why can we use game theory? Because if a problem is a small event, we do not depend on the context to explain the problem. A duel between two airplanes does not need understanding of the cause of a war. When we want to apply game theory to politics in practice, we take into account four aspects. First, the structure of risk and reward. Second, the shadow of the future. Third, sanctioning problems to defectors combined with a large number of players.
A broader structure of risk and reward, as the first aspect,
affects whether cooperation happens. This is called the payoff structure. The greater the conflict of interest between players, the greater the chance that players choose to defect. The perception of interests and power is shown in the case where states mobilized their armies before the First World War broke out. For instance, Russia mobilized its entire army as a response to an Austrian invasion of Serbia. But Russia knew that doing so would equally create a German counter-mobilization, because Germany would not come to the aid of Austria, which necessitated a Russian complete mobilization rather than a partial mobilization, which in turn caused other allies to mobilize. Further, the states perceived the advantage of militaries to be on the offensive, which meant they must strike sooner than their opponents. However, this caused opponents to reason in the same way. This case showed a change in game from prisoner's dilemma to deadlock, because mobilization was no longer a dilemma, but rather inevitable.
The shadow of the future, as the second aspect, is about concerns about the future.
It explains the difference between military and economic cooperation. In the case of German aggression in the World Wars, Germany reasoned that if they did not take drastic military action immediately, then eventually in the long term, Germany would be overpowered by its continental opponents. However, with quick aggression, the opponents would be eliminated forever.
Sanctioning problems with large number of players, as the third aspect,
are the difficulties that states sometimes face when they want to punish a defector to a cooperation game.
Reciprocity
is the idea that states can reliably give back to partners what is given to them. This is difficult when defectors or freeloaders cannot be easily found, or when retaliation cannot be focused on cheaters, or when incentives to punish are lacking. I give examples of those three reasons.
In terms of defector identification,
terrorist attacks are clandestine in nature and can thus not be easily tracked to the source.
In terms of defector punishment,
in the 16th century, English pirates raided German trade, but German traders could not retaliate against the pirates, so they retaliated against English merchants. This escalated the conflict rather than stopping the conflict.
In terms of punishment incentives,
in 1931, Britain devalued its currency, which caused harm to foreign economies. However, although it hurt everyone, no single country could devote all its resources to changing British policy. I personally think a good example of this are the failed climate change agreement. Now I will delve deeper in the initial observation, namely that the context of interaction shapes how and why states cooperate. International institutions, appearing as international organizations, but also appearing as international modes of interacting, define this context. They alter the payoff structure, they lengthen the shadow of the future, and enable games with large numbers of players to be broken down into games with smaller numbers of actors. Different games affect one another while the political issues are linked. The outcomes of a game affect the outcome of a different game. This is called a multi-level game. Issue linkage refers to one political issue being linked to a different political issue. We distinguish between back-scratching tactics, which improve welfare levels, and blackmailing tactics, which reduce welfare levels. Back-scratching implies a promise. Blackmailing implies a threat, as Schilling points out.
The difference is that a promise is costly when it succeeds, and a threat is costly when it fails.
A blackmailer threatens to act against its own interests. For instance, a debtor country may threaten a default to a creditor country. The threat, if carried out, leaves both parties worse off. A backscratcher, on the other hand, offers acting against its own interest in return for compensation. For instance, a debtor country may ask for an easier payment schedule for a loan in fear of facing revolt. If the demand is not met, a default happens. In practice, it may not be easy to see the difference here, but it helps us to recognize issue linkages. An important point is the contextual issue linkage. Here, a bargain is placed in a more important long-term relationship in such a way that that relationship affects the outcome of the bargain. For instance, in 1936, France, Britain, and the US were finally able to agree on international monetary reform because the three countries had a common concern from the threat of Nazi Germany. Next, some games may be compatible or incompatible with one another. This means that they can exclude one another in politics and cannot exist side by side. For instance, negotiations on international issues like energy trade give good results for the participants only if negotiations are held between a small number of industrialized actors. However, once a large number of underdeveloped parties are included, the negotiations no longer give a result where everyone wants to cooperate with one another, and then no one wants to cooperate with one another. Next, a strategy within games, such as the Prisoner's Dilemma, is tit for tat. When repeating the game, the strategy tells you to defect the next game as a punishment for the other player's defection in the last game. In international trade, this can be explained as a tariff being imposed as a punishment for another country's tariff. The danger with this is that it can lead to a trade war, which is a cycle of retaliations. The Soviet-American acceleration of hostilities is an example of this. The other party kept retaliating against the first party. This is an
echo effect.
Perception of interests is also again involved here. The Soviets believed that the Americans were taking advantage of the Soviet reciprocal attitude, and vice versa. Now, we will answer the question of our investigation, namely how to achieve international cooperation. The answer is that we must always try to cooperate with the other in a strategy of reciprocity, backscratching and cooperation, rather than tit-for-tat, blackmail and defection. We do this by being aware of the pitfalls of the other strategies. We must be aware of the echo effects, bargaining deadlocks, and issue interdependence. By being aware in this way, we can compensate. Because leaders live far away from each other, they focus on just their own surroundings, and less so on how their actions will affect the minds and perceptions of other leaders. This must change. Trade wars begin when we have exaggerated expectations of the other party. International institutions, then, should focus on providing incentives for cooperation, monitoring behavior so that cooperation is rewarded and defections is punished, while also linking issues with one another and playing multi-level games. That will bring about a general welfare gain.